Hey guys, it's Chloe, and welcome back to the Salty Blues YouTube channel. We're glad you're here. We're gonna talk about things that new hobbyists should know before they even start setting up their first saltwater tank. These are all things that I wish that I personally knew when I first started out in the hobby. I would have saved myself a lot of time, a lot of money, a lot of heartache in general. But there's definitely some things that you can know ahead of time that will make your experience a lot better. The number one thing you can do to make sure that you're successful in this hobby is do your research. It is always worth it if you're looking at a certain type of fish. Research as much as you can about that fish. What is the max size? What size tank should it be in? What does it eat? Is it aggressive to other fish? Will it eat coral? So these are all things to consider before you even go to the LFS. One of the best ways to learn is joining the online forums, such as the Salty Blues Forum on our website, or reef2reef.com, reefcentral.com, or nano-reef.com. These are all places where you'll find other reefers, often with the exact same setups as you, especially on nano-reef.com, because they're usually all-in-one aquariums, so you can get tons of ideas and hear other people's actual experiences with the equipment and the types of animals that you plan to keep. Back to the LFS is making sure that you find a good LFS that you can trust. So I know that that's not always possible, but it is really a gem when you can ask them, hey, what should I do? What would work good in my tank? We will always tell you the truth. So hopefully you all out there can find a fish store that will do the same for you and have your best interest in mind. The next thing that you'll want to know before starting your reef tank is how much of a time commitment it's going to be. You'll be doing daily topping off. So what that means is you're keeping the water level the same. So you'll be adding fresh water, not salt water, back to the tank, because the water will evaporate but the salt will not. So you're adding fresh water back in order to maintain the same salinity level at all times. You can get an auto top off that will automatically pump the water in for you, so you only have to fill the reservoir, say, once a week. Do not want to use tap water. I like to control as many variables as possible with the reef tank because you are investing so much of your time and your effort and your heart into it. You don't want to make big mistakes. You could have major algae outbreaks with tap water. It's best to use high quality RODI water that you either make yourself and are very diligent about your filters and having zero TDS, total dissolved solids, or you're buying from a trusted LFS. Weekly, you'll be doing about a 10% water change in the smaller tanks. That's what I like to do because you pull out all the bad junk and you put a lot of the good stuff back in. The key with your water change is match the salt water as closely to the tank as possible so that you're not shocking anything when you pour the water into the tank. The two most important things to match would be your temperature. Also want to match your specific gravity or your salinity. That's very, very important. That is the key to all of salt water, is the amount of salt that is in the water. Monthly, you're going to be pulling out all your equipment, so anything like a skimmer, clean them really well so that there's no buildup on them and they're working at their top efficiency. You're also going to change any filter media that you have, like carbon. And that brings us to choosing your first saltwater aquarium. There's tons of all-in-one kits on the market. Most of them are going to be under, say, 65 gallons. Those are usually what I recommend to first-time reefers because they give you majority of what you need for equipment, and you can always upgrade things later. Brands like the Innovative Marine Nuvo Fusion series are awesome because they are a blank slate. It has the all-in-one filtration chambers in the back. You can use whatever kind of lighting that you would like. They're really good value and they're super beautiful and super high quality. Larger tanks may be more stable and they have more room for livestock, but you're also going to end up spending a little bit more money in regular maintenance and how much water you need to do for water changes. So sometimes the smaller tanks can actually be easier just in that they're a little bit less work. The next thing to be prepared for before starting your first saltwater tank is to make sure that you understand the nitrogen cycle and what it means to cycle your tank before you put livestock in. You may have heard that you have to let a saltwater aquarium sit for a few weeks before you can put any fish in, which is very true. We like to use the fishless cycle method, using completely dry live rock. Pour the entire bottle of your Dr. Kim's one and only nitrifying bacteria into the tank, and then go ahead and dose the ammonium chloride, which is basically simulating the fish poop. So that will start the cycle. Usually see the fishless cycle take no more than 3 to 4 weeks. What you're waiting for, giving that bacteria time to feed on that ammonium chloride, reproducing and colonizing 100% of the surface area on on the rocks. When you dose the ammonium chloride into the tank, you're waiting for that 2 ppm to drop down to zero. As it's starting to drop down to zero, you're going to see your nitrite start rising. You're going to see it peak out and start dropping back down, and then you'll start to see your nitrates coming up. And that is when you know that you're fully cycled. To follow the nitrifying cycle, you need to know what your concentration of ammonia, nitrite, and nitrate are at. So you will need some test kits. There are definitely higher quality, accurate test kits and not so accurate test kits out there. So you definitely want to go with a brand like Red Sea or Salifer or Hannah. Okay, patience. Patience is number one in this hobby. There is nothing else to that. You have to be patient. Only bad things happen fast in this hobby. Next is tank placement. So you want to make sure that your tank is located near a wall outlet so that you can plug in all of the equipment that you need. You also want to make sure that the tank is not near a window or direct light that can cause problems with temperature swings or algae blooms because of too much light. You also want to keep the tank away from any drafts or doors or heating and air conditioning vents. You also want to make sure that you have clear access to the top, the back, the sides. You don't want to kind of just tuck it in a corner where you can't really access anything. It's going to be really hard to make adjustments if you need to. Also close to the sink so that when you do your water changes, you don't have to haul water super far. This one is probably one of the most important things on this list, is quarantining fish. This is not talked about near as much as it should be in this hobby, but you definitely want to quarantine your fish no matter where you buy them from. Definitely want to quarantine all fish going into your tank because, again, controlling as many variables as you can. There are a lot of parasites that you won't see before it causes a problem or spreads to other fish. So you want to put it in a separate tank from your main display for about 4 to 6 weeks. You can prophylactically treat with medication, or you can just observe the fish and 4 weeks later, if everything seems good, go ahead and throw them into your main tank. The other thing that quarantine is good for, not just preventing diseases, but getting the fish acclimated to your schedule when they're coming from their stressful trip from the ocean to the supplier, to our store, to your tank. If you're gonna keep the fish for the rest of its life, then it is well worth it to provide that fish with the best chance of having a long, healthy life. Along with quarantining your fish, you'll want to dip your corals. In a solution like Coral RX is used to kill coral pests, it's pretty easy to use. It doesn't take long at all, about 10 minutes, and that can save you a lot of trouble in the long run. Dips don't kill all pests, especially pests like algae and Aptasia and vermetid snails. You'll want to inspect the coral. It is a good idea to have an emergency plan. The two things you want to maintain in case of a power outage: circulation for the gas exchange, oxygenation. You also want to make sure that the water stays to temp. It doesn't get too hot or too cold. And it's really important, even in times of not an emergency, to have some extra RO DI water and some extra salt water mixed up on hand, ready to go. That brings us to aquascaping. This is one of my favorite parts of having a reef tank, is building the initial rockscape. Just making sure that it's a nice sturdy structure to begin with. You want to make sure you start building your rockscape off of the glass, not off of the sand, because if you start on the sand, if you have any sand sifters going underneath, they will collapse the rockwork on themselves. Bonus points if you put egg crate down underneath, that will help hold the rocks in place and give you even less pressure points on the glass. You also want to leave negative space so that your corals can actually grow and fill in that space. When I'm building my rockwork, I like to have the LEDs on so that you avoid any shadow, and you'll want to use medium grain sand like Fiji pink. When you go with the thicker, it'll definitely turn darker, and with the finer stuff, it can get blown around a whole heck of a lot. All right, guys, well, those are the top things you need to know before you even start your saltwater aquarium. If you think I missed anything or you learned something from starting out in the hobby, leave a comment down below and let us know what it is so that we can help other new hobbyists not make mistakes that we've made before. And don't forget to subscribe here on YouTube, hit that notification bell, and leave a comment down below if you like this video, and let us know what you want to see in the next one. And you can like us on Facebook to follow our daily activities, as well as when we get new shipments in. That's where we post the most. We also have an Instagram that shows all the highlights of things going on at Salty Blues, so give us a follow there at Salty Blues DSM. Join the Salty Blues forum on our website, get good ideas, ask questions, share pictures, really nice, friendly community. Go to our website, saltybluesdsm.com, to get all of our contact exact info and hours. Don't forget that we'll be having online inventory coming, so keep an eye out for that. You really want to break it down. The key is having fun, enjoying it. Every step of the way is part of the fun. Even when that rock is completely white, before you even have water in the tank, it's still so exciting because you're starting with a blank slate and you're about to build an ecosystem from different bacteria to different microorganisms to different fish and coral. The hobby is the process of doing what you're doing. If you had a car and you're building the car, it's not just the hobby. Once the car is built, it's building the car exactly how you wanted it to be built. Same thing with reef tank. Don't be scared to make mistakes. These are live animals. There are things that we don't fully understand, whether we're a beginner or 10 years into the hobby. Don't ever feel bad to ask questions. Connecting with other reefers is how this hobby has grown from the beginning. Well, thanks for stopping by, and we'll see you in our next video on Thursday. Bye.